inside me feels like we met somewhere before. Saw you, my heart just hit the floor. This time I'm following the signs. This moment can flash before your eyes. So if we just can't get it right, then maybe we'll try in another life. If I die in your arms tonight, then maybe I'll see you on the other side. So if we just can't get it right, then maybe we'll try.
So I wanted to make this video to tell you a story about how I really got into skilling. I wanted to tell the story of Winter Fantasy EHP of 2018. Before I can tell you that story, I have to explain how the competition worked. There were 8 teams in a round-robin competition style, with top 4 teams advancing to playoffs consisting of semifinals and finals. Every team played each other in the regular season in a 1-week EHP competition, 1 week per matchup. An EHP is an efficient hour played. This doesn't mean the absolute maximum amount of XP you can gain per hour, but what is considered an efficient hour within reason. Let me give you an example. The EHP method for mining is 3 tick 4 granite. The maximum XP per hour is about 133k per hour, but the EHP rate is about 125k per hour. Sure, you can get some over EHP, but over the long term you probably won't average over 125k per hour. This metric was used across all skills in the competition, and there were rules in place to make sure no players were getting more than 1 EHP per hour physically played. Some methods were also under EHP in this competition. For example, here we can talk about agility. Agility EHP was 70k per hour, but most people did arty rooftops, which was about 60k per hour. This is commonly referred to as 0.8. which means every hour you play, you are receiving 0.8 of 1 EHP, rather than a 1-to-1 ratio. So the video started out with the draft, and how it worked. But how did that draft work? It worked like this. Each team got to select any player in the game they wanted. There were no signups, no nothing. The draft pick order was decided previously, completely random. Who was good to pick? The random player might think, oh, well, you would just pick people by rank, and default to players like Lynx Titan and Hey Jace. Well, yes, these players are very high ranked and very prestigious, known players, but will they log in 6 hours before the competition starts and put in the effort? Or will they even join your team's locker room? This is why some of these high ranked players might not even get picked. Lynx wasn't chosen in this fantasy because of how close he was to 200 mil all skills. Sure, you might get 1 or 2 weeks out of him, but he's going to run out of XP eventually. Hey Jace? He might just keep to himself like he usually does and do his own thing. There's nothing wrong with that, but that is just what might happen. You need to pick people you can count on. Fantasy is where legends are made. Nobody's turned into complete skilling beasts after fantasy. You can pick anyone you want, but the one thing is that if they are already taken, you can't have them. So higher value players will be picked earlier. How do you value players? Well, you value them by how much EHP you think they are capable of across the competition. This could be based off of past performances, or even just going off of what people said they would do. The draft is not something to be slept on, as it is a huge part of fantasy. The draft can go really good for you, but it can also go really bad. What if you draft someone that you're not that good of friends with? What if they don't want to play as hard for you as they would for someone else? What if they aren't planning on playing during this time period? Maybe getting a job or something. Anything could happen. This makes it even more competitive and makes it is what it is. Your fantasy team can either become a complete brotherhood with people you'll remember forever, or your fantasy team could never talk. You never know. How did I feel being a pick number 8 overall and the Seagulls' first pick when I was barely even a post-max account? Did I doubt myself? Did I think I had what it takes? Was I really worth that much? I don't know. Adam, the captain of the Seagulls, must have thought so. All I knew was I was excited for this competition and I wanted to put my best effort into it. Further into the draft got even harder. We had a strong first few picks, but at the end of the day, our team was full of new players, noobs, and speed. Speed was a seasoned skiller at the time. He knew how to do most methods and how to win these sort of competitions. So our team really began to rely on him throughout the competition for guidance on how to play efficiently, and he taught us that every minute counts in these competitions. Sure, there's some room for some real life stuff, but you best be gaining some XP on your phone if you can. So where did all this come from? What the hell even is fantasy, and why is this even a thing? Well, if you're an old RuneScape player, you might remember the commonly known as Hexus Summer Fantasy EHP. This competition went pretty viral in the RuneScape community at the time for how many hours were being played. Brand new methods like essence running were found in this fantasy. This fantasy was legendary. Hours played by skillers were higher than anyone had ever even imagined was possible for RuneScape. Players in the final weeks of it played up to 140 and a few even 150 hours in a single week. Fantasy was something extremely special to skillers. This didn't happen every week, nor every year. Fantasy was where you could make a name for yourself in the skilling community. It's a great introduction and gateway into the skilling scene for some players. It gave players a reason to go out there and achieve their goals with a team. Skilling can often be very lonely and solo. This made it more team-oriented and helped us socialize, meet new people. Now, we didn't expect Winter Fantasy to even come close to how that last fantasy was, but we would be surprised. Let's talk about Week 1. Week 1 was a pressure test to see which team wanted it and which team didn't want it. Every single player in the competition was extremely motivated, and if you've ever played in these competitions, you know that everyone is going to give it their all Week 1. Week 1 is the easiest. Week 1 was hard for me because I had to figure out what skills I wanted to train, which skill was best for me to try and gain the most one-to-one EHP I could. I was in school at the time, so I was juggling my classes, driving to university and back, and doing all this at the same time. We ended up playing the Ionian Iceni Week 1 and taking a victory. This set the stage for us for the entire competition because we were on top. Every team played Week 1, and every team either won or lost. So every team was either undefeated or had a loss under their belt. Up next was Week 2. All of these competitions were ran back to back. If your team didn't win by enough in Week 1, your team may not be able to 6-hour into the next week. 6-houring into the next week means that you would play for 6 hours before the competition started, and then log out once the competition started and drop those 6 hours worth of XP gained. This is commonly confused with stored XP, which it is not. It was allowed for this competition, and all players used it to their benefit. We made sure we won Week 1 by enough margin where we could 6-hour our players into Week 2. Week 2, we were up against the Brimhaven Breadgetters. The Breadgetters had multiple seasoned players like Genitalia, Vior or Harmony, Ooktism, and Stay Skill Alt. We were a team of noobs up against a fully suited team of good skillers and players that knew how to win. Speed was able to play this week and told us that he was going to match Vior's hours, so we wouldn't have to worry about him outplaying us. All we had to do was match the rest. This week was our first true test as a team to see if we had what it took to win. This week went to about day 5, and Speed ended up doing a 140 EHP week of fishing and us taking the win. We were now 2-0. We started to get hype and started feeling like playoffs were possible for us. To make playoffs, all we had needed to do was be in the top 4 teams. Weeks 3 to 7 were pretty insignificant for us. Other teams would go up against us and count it as an automatic loss. They knew we would play hard if we needed to win, and if we didn't, we would rest and recharge for the next week. The Breadgetters were 0-2 at the start of Week 3. We began to start to think that they were completely out of the competition. We knew how hard it would be for them to come back from being 0-2. We started to really see a path to victory of the entire competition if they were eliminated. Vior got to grinding and did the mining month record during these weeks and carried his team to playoffs. Was there drama in fantasy? Was there banter between teams? Of course. I can think of so many old memes and tweets that were made, whether it was just shit talking or trolling other teams. It was fun if you let it be and made for even more competitiveness. It also brought more competitiveness between the skilling clans, which would really get people fired up and ready to drop some hours for their team. Some players are turned off by this. Some are extremely amped up by it. Just depends what kind of person you are. I know personally for myself, it was an extremely motivating thing when someone said I couldn't do something. Oh, he can't play this much, or oh, he doesn't want to do this skill, or oh, he can't do this skill. That would motivate me so much that I would go and learn how to do a skill I didn't even want to train, how to do it perfectly and how, get the most EHP per hour possible out of it. One of the biggest motivators I remember was Vinny from my team. After the draft ended, one of the makers of the league made a write-up that discussed which team he thought was the best and with a breakdown of it. I remember he wrote that Vinny wasn't a great pick and wouldn't start. After Vinny saw that, he knew he had to prove himself. Vinny popped off every damn week he was on that roster, and he played most, if not all, weeks. He was a beast. Playoffs are here. We made it. We beat the teams that had given up and were 0-2, 0-3, and 1-3 in order to finalize our season at 5-2. We only lost 2 games in the regular season, and it was just because we were all too busy with finals weeks to get to the perfect season without any losses. Our losses only held us back from the privilege of coming in first during the regular season. This privilege gave your team the option of who they wanted to play in the playoffs. The Jigig Jostlers came in first. They chose the Box Traps to play against in the playoffs, so our team was forced to play against the Bread Getters again. We knew what we were up against. This time was going to be different, though. Speed was busy. He couldn't play for this match, so we were forced to play this competition without him against the Bread Getters. I took the news pretty tough. I was scared. How are we going to beat this team of insane players with a team of noobs? How are we meant to do this? Are we going to just to waste our 5-2 record and lay down and lose? No. We devised a plan. We were going to leave it absolutely all on the field. We chose our best six and went with it. We had a plan. Every second of this week counts. If we go take a shower for 10 minutes, those 10 minutes might matter at the end. Every meal we eat will add up. We have to be gaining the most EHP the best we can. So that's what we did. We picked our best six and went with it. We all had a plan. Some of our players had a few obligations that week, but everyone was free for the first few days. The competition started, everyone started their 6-hour logs, and at the end of the 6 hours, while everyone is refreshing their CML pages at the end of the 6 hour, we checked the Bread Getter score about 30 minutes in. We realized that Genitalia didn't have a 6-hour log. We started about 5 hours ahead. Once I saw this, I knew that we could win. All we had to do was keep that 5-hour advantage to the end, and we would win. I knew from the start that most of the Bread Getters were probably lining up to do a 150 that week. A 150 is a term for a 150 EHP week. There are 168 hours in 1 week, plus the 6-hour log at the start, so 174. I knew that I had to match Vior in Speed's absence, and I knew I could do it if I put my mind to it. I had never even stayed up anything past 24 hours, but I was so determined to win that I stayed up 42 hours playing straight. I got the Slayer Day record at the time, and we were still winning. I decided to stop refreshing the scores at that time and take some time to sleep. Our entire team was on board with this, and we all worked together to make sure no one overslept. I lay down for 3 hours, and my phone was ringing from my teammates waking me up. It was so hard to wake up after 3 hours after being up for 42, but I knew it would be worth it. Day after day, we got up after less than 3 hours of sleep. Some of our players were sleeping 1.5 hours a night some nights. The entire skilling community was watching and cheering us on. Even Bodhi was checking the scores on his stream at the time. We were ahead and we were winning. On day 5, we were on pace for the most EHP in a team competition ever. This was a legendary week. Weak records were going to be completely smashed and multiple records were already broken. We kept moving forward and got to day 5. Day 5 was the absolute hardest for me. I remember I did Slayer the entire week. I was playing 4 accounts, my main, my alt lure, and 2 spec transfer alts. This was so much effort and brain power with such little sleep, I was falling apart. I didn't know if I could keep going. I felt sick, lightheaded, and completely destroyed. When I was about to give up, I got a Kalphites task. I told myself I wasn't going to double to spec transfer it and just AFK it and do it on my phone and take a walk to get some air. I took 15 minutes for that and did the task on my phone and came back. We pressed on for a few more hours. I was about to give up. I was absolutely toasted. I wanted to leave everything on the field, so I kept going. This week felt like do or die when it came to winning. We knew we didn't want to put all of our effort to waste, so we all kept going as a team. Everybody's tired. We were still in the lead, and we had to keep it that way. When I was as close as I could get to giving up, we got a message from Vior. We hadn't really spoke to each other much about numbers or anything during this competition, just as friends. He told us that genitalia was giving up. He had a migraine. He told us GG. We didn't believe him at first, so we did a few more hours until we saw that genitalia wasn't dropping XP on CML anymore. At this point, we knew we had won. We did it. We eliminated the best team at the time. We won. Finals are here. We made it. We're here. We are in the finals. There was a 48-hour break between the end of the semifinals and finals. We played against the Pryfidus Box Traps. We had talked amongst our team, and we were in trouble. Most of our players had to start classes on day 5 of the competition. We didn't know who could play and who had the most free time. After discussing what would be best, we had to devise a plan on how to win. We picked our starters, and our plan was to win by day 5. How can we win a 7-day competition by day 5? We had to make the other team completely give up by day 3 or 4, so that we could have enough room to go to class that week. Our plan was to all out blitz the competition and win by day 3 or 4. We started out just like we did in the last week. We went hard at the start and took the lead. All we had to do was extend our lead enough so that the enemy team would give up. So we did just that. We went hard at the start, and every day we were going up by about 25 EHP against the box traps. By day 3, we were almost 100 EHP ahead, and we knew we had it in the bag. All we needed was them to let us know enough is enough and GG's. We waited and waited. Day 4, we were over 100 hours ahead, and they still hadn't given up. Day 5 came, and we finally got it. The GG message from the box traps captain, Levine. We had done it. We took a team of absolute noobs and won against these other teams full of seasoned skillers. What should you take away from this video? I was never the same after this. I took this effort and motivation into multiple aspects of my life and still do today. I think about how hard that semis week was and how low our odds were to win, but we still won. This changed the game and my life forever.